Hello, everyone. My name is Fernando Villafuerte. I'm a graduate student in the group of Julia Greer here at Caltech, and I study batteries. And today I'm going to talk to you about why I study, how I came to study this, and why it matters. And the title of my talk today is Science Journeys, Enabling Next Generation Batteries for Energy Storage. So before I begin the discussion of my research in depth, I do want to lay down a bit of the motivation for what I study, and that mainly has to do with enabling the transition to renewable energy technologies. When we speak about a renewable energy, we generally think of things like wind. I've got a wind turbine here to illustrate that point. We think about solar energy as well. I've got some solar panels here on the screen for you. And the challenge with actually enabling transition to these technologies has to do with the fact that these are intermittent sources of energy, which means that they don't produce energy consistently throughout the day. And moreover, they don't necessarily produce this energy when we need it the most. And a nice way of looking at this problem or understanding this from this diagram, it's colloquially known as the duck curve. And what it demonstrates is that peak power production for solar, for example, here in the state of California, doesn't overlap very nicely with when we need it the most. So on this vertical axis, the amount of power, and on the horizontal axis, it's just the time of day. And I've indicated on this horizontal axis the times of sunrise and sunset. And if you follow this line from early in the day to sunrise, that is telling you the amount of power being consumed on California's grid at that given time. And then after sunrise, we see that this line splits into two parts. The dotted line shows what energy load on the grid or on California's grid would be in the absence of solar power, whereas the solid line shows what it would be with California's already existing solar power capacity. And we see right away that the generation of solar power at these peak times when the sun is shining actually depresses the amount of energy on the grid. However, as you get closer and closer to sunset, we see a convergence again, and all that energy that was generated via solar power, indicated by the shaded yellow area, is no longer being produced, but the demand for energy on the grid increases pretty substantially. And it looks kind of like a duck. And this is problematic because we generate all this energy, but there's no way to capture it for when we need it in the nighttime. And we need to think about ways of storing this energy and using it at times when we actually need it. So there are a number of potential solutions that people are proposing to store energy generated from intermittent sources like solar and wind, but the most immediately apparent way to do this is probably to use already existing lithium-ion battery technology, common everywhere in all manner of electronics, like this cell phone battery I've got on the screen for you. And the idea would be to make much larger versions of these, put them in something like a storage container, as I've got here on the screen for you, and then put this on site next to a solar or wind farm to capture energy as it's generated. The reason we haven't actually been employing lithium-ion battery technologies on this scale to store renewable energy namely has to do with a safety concern with these batteries, namely the fact that under certain conditions, they can actually combust, much like I'm going to show you here in this video. And if we stop here, we've seen that this battery explodes, in this case, under what's known as a short circuit. But there are a number of other conditions under which this can happen as well. So one of the key barriers to actually enabling this kind of technology comes to addressing this particular problem. But before I go any further, this talk is called Science Journey, and I think I owe it to you to tell you a little bit about how exactly I came to study this kind of thing and to tell you a little about who I am. So I could begin by telling you directly about my educational journey and my experience growing up, but I tend to think that these stories are generational in nature, and I think I owe it to my parents to tell a little bit of their story as well to understand, or for you to understand, how I became the person I am today and why I study what I study. So here are my parents. I've got a picture of them here on the left. That's my father, Joaquin, and my mother, Mercedes. They were both immigrants from Latin America. My dad is from Peru, my mom from the Dominican Republic. And I've got two images here on the bottom of the places they grew up in. So the bottom left there is actually a picture of the exact apartment building my father grew up in Lima. It's from a working class district in the center of the city called La Victoria, which translates to victory in English. And on the bottom right there, I've got a picture of Dajabón, which is a province in the Dominican Republic on the border with Haiti, where my mom grew up for a number of years, well, till the age of 10 before her family ended up moving to Puerto Rico. And I should tell you that my parents weren't able to achieve on the same level educationally I was for lack of opportunity. But that being said, they still came to value education and intellectual inquiry, and that came from how their childhoods were structured and how their childhood influences as well. So in the case of my father, I've got my grandfather here on the left who shares my name. He's Fernando. And though he didn't have much formal education, he was intellectually curious in a number of ways. And as family stories have him, he dabbled in a number of things from archaeology. I believe he was able to find some work as an assistant for a famous archaeologist in Peru and worked in a museum close to where my father grew up. And he also dabbled in things related to astronomy and also messing around with creating a writing system for some indigenous languages in Peru. And though my father wasn't able himself to pursue the kind of advanced education that I was able to, he admired his grandfather very greatly, and he passed on that particular characteristic and admiration for his grandfather to me and to my siblings. And in the case of my mother, this is her mother on the far right, Antonia. In my mother's case, from a very early age, she was taught how to read, a very avid reader, and that became an escape for her. And moreover, her childhood, she had a lot of latitude to explore the region around where she grew up. So a lot of days spent kind of wandering around in the local forest and countryside, and I felt like that contributed pretty heavily to her creativity and her curiosity, and something she passed on to me as well. And though my mother as well wasn't able to pursue the kind of advanced education I did, she always valued learning and educating herself about a number of things. And even growing up, we would watch Jeopardy together. And I'd always try to compete with her and see if I could answer as many questions as my mom could. And coming here to the States, they weren't able to pursue those opportunities for themselves, but they did work and find the stability in order for me and my siblings to continue that story. So now that I've told you about my parents, I think you'll have a better picture of how I actually came to be a scientist. So I'll start by telling you a little bit about the place I grew up in. I've got a picture of it here. This is the street I grew up in Brooklyn. And you can't tell from the image here, but there are these two churches on either side of the street, and there aren't supposed to be any cars parked there. There are here in this image, but growing up there weren't any, and this was our play space. So much in the way my mother had this unstructured space to develop creatively, I think we had that as kids as well, and we'd be out on the street in the summer months particularly, playing any number of games from hide and seek to games we made up as well, in addition to more traditional sports. That being said, my parents did value education. They did want us to achieve in school, and they were always very on top of that. And I've got an image here on the bottom that just popped up of me in sixth grade when I received this award for academic achievement from the office of the Brooklyn Borough President. So there was one student selected from every sixth grade class in public schools throughout Brooklyn, and I was the one for my school. From here, I went on to high school, and then I went on to college, to Cornell, where I got my first bachelor's degree in German and international relations. And from there, I wanted to pursue a career that was intellectually satisfying, but also had some social impact. So I did a year as an AmeriCorps volunteer at a social service agency in Astoria, Queens, where I led ESL classes and also this seminar series on the college admissions process at the local library for local high schoolers. And from there, I spent a number of years actually working as a paralegal for this nonprofit appellate defense firm in New York as well. But as I grew older, even though I valued the social impact of the work I did, I didn't find it intellectually stimulating to the same degree or to the degree that I had hoped. And you start to think about these larger scale social problems, climate change and the like, and you begin to realize that, wow, the people who are really tackling this or trying to solve this are working in things like science and engineering. And at that point, I decided, well, I think I'd like to go back to school and pivot my career, so to speak, and try to do something that could help in that regard. So I went back to school, this time Hunter College, which is part of the City University of New York system, and I studied physics this time. And while there, I stumbled upon the lab of Professor Steven Greenbaum, my first scientific advisor, that specialized in using spectroscopic techniques to study materials for energy storage. From there, I was able to get an internship at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory here in Pasadena, and that's what ultimately led me to my current PhD here at the here at Caltech, and where I study batteries now in the group of Julia Greer. So in the context of my own background, my family's background, I think that the reason I've come to study batteries is because I believe it's a very socially relevant thing to study, namely as it pertains to dealing with things like climate change or enabling renewable energy storage technologies. And now that we've discussed that, I can tell you a little bit about the meat of my research. But before we get there, I do have to tell you a little bit about how battery works and how it's made. So I've got a mock-up of a battery here on the screen. And battery, very simply, consists of three general components. You've got your anode, your electrolyte, and your cathode. The anode's historically known as the negative terminal and the cathode the positive. And what happens is that this anode and cathode are made from materials that if you were to mix them or bring them into contact with each other, they undergo this spontaneous reaction where there's an exchange of electrons or electrical current. And the way we like to talk about this kind of phenomenon is in terms of energy. So I've got a ball on top of a hill here, and the amount of energy stored in the system goes up towards the top of the hill. And this ball, it's stable at the top of the hill, but any slight push will force it down the hill, and it'll expand the energy it has charged at the top of the hill as it goes down to the bottom, and it'll eventually come to rest. And in a fashion very similar to this, the anode and cathode materials, when they're separate from each other, they exist in kind of this high energy state like the ball at the top of the hill. And when you mix them together, they discharge that energy much like the ball rolling down the hill. And this process stops once the electrical current stops, which would be analogous to this ball stopping at the bottom of the hill. And what someone figured out at some point was, instead of actually putting these materials in contact with each other, let's put this electrically insulating material in between. That is a material that doesn't allow the conduction of electrons, and will force the electrons to go outside through a circuit we make to do the work we need it to do. And that's exactly what's happening in this diagram. The electrons can't go directly across the electrolyte between the anode and the cathode, so instead they're forced to go outside to power the devices we want them to. And in modern day batteries, the source of that energy, the source of those electrons, are actually lithium atoms. It's third in the periodic table. And the reason we like it so much is that it's relatively light, so you can pack a lot of it into a small space. And moreover, it actually has a dangling electron in its outermost shell that it's very eager to get rid of. So it doesn't require a lot of prodding for us to pull that electron out and into an electrical circuit to do the work we need for us. And much like the ball on the top of the hill, just as a little nudge gets that ball down the hill, just connecting lithium in the proper battery configuration to some external circuit will get you the electrical current you need to do the work you want. So what exactly is lithium doing in the battery? Well, before you hook up the battery to anything, in a fully charged state, all the lithium is actually sitting in the anode, much like I have in this diagram here. And when you hook it up to a device to do work, in this case, using the light bulb example again, the lithium actually gives up that electron. And as the electrons go outside to the circuit to do the work we want them to do, the lithium atoms that have given up those electrons actually become what are known as ions. And they become positively charged, whereas the electrons are negatively charged. And they balance the electrical current going outside to power our stuff by generating a positive current through the inside of the battery. So while the electrons go outside to do the work we want, the lithium atoms that gave up those electrons become ionized, and then they then travel through the inside of the battery to the cathode side. And once the battery has been fully discharged, all the lithium travels from the anode and then inserts itself back into the cathode again. where the electrons come and complete the reaction. And this is the fully discharged state. And if we wanted to, we could run this reaction in reverse and then force the battery to charge. And what happens is that the electrons would just go in the reverse direction and the lithium atoms too, until we're in the charged state. And what I study is specifically this part in the middle called the electrolyte. And this is kind of the source of the problem we saw in that video earlier with the explosion. This is what actually generates a lot of our problems. And the way this happens is primarily through a mechanism known as a short. So in the typical battery setup, what's supposed to happen is that all the electrical current is supposed to travel outside to do the work we need it to do. But in some instances, the lithium that gives up those electrons, they don't always slide in and out of the anode and cathode materials in the way we hope or design the system to do. And sometimes they actually end up glomming on the surface and they form these protrusions, these features that grow out of the surface of the anode and the cathode, and we call these dendrites. And over time, they can grow and grow until they meet across the inside of the battery. And a thing you should know about this lithium is that it's actually metal. And if these dendrites grow sufficiently for them to connect across inside of the battery, inside the electrolyte, they actually provide a mechanism or a means for the electrons to just go directly across the inside of the battery because metals conduct electricity. And when this happens, all that energy that we've been dissipating by powering some external device gets discharged all at once through the inside of the battery, and this generates a lot of heat. And this electrolyte is generally made from liquid-like materials that are very flammable. Not too dissimilar from gasoline, they're organic molecules, and a lot of them come from the same sources. And they're not as reactive, but given enough heat and energy, they can combust in much the same fashion. And then we end up with these explosions, much like the ones I showed you earlier. So how exactly can we go about overcoming some of these problems or overcoming this principal problem? And as I told you just now, the electrolyte generally consists of organic liquid molecules or materials that can combust when given enough heat. And one way to circumvent this is to actually replace that liquid material with a fully solid electrolyte material that's more chemically stable and won't allow for the formations of those dendrites by essentially pressing down on them or inhibiting their growth. And there are a number of people working on this problem. And the nice thing about these solid electrolytes is that they're not as vulnerable to this shorting problem or to external abuse, which can also cause these kinds of explosions. A nice demonstration of the effectiveness of these solid electrolytes comes in the form of this video. There's this company out in Massachusetts that's actually developed a solid electrolyte for use in batteries. And as you'll see in the video I'm about to show you, these don't short when you poke them or subject them to damage of any kind. So they're very stable and they're still able to power the device they're attached to, despite that kind of abuse and that intent to get them to short deliberately. So I'll go ahead and play that video so you can see.
I'm alive! Wow. Look at that. And guess what? The lights are still on. This is like a Houdini thing.
As demonstrated in the video, this stuff seems to work pretty well. And if people are working so intently on this problem, it would seem as if we have a solution to this combustibility problem. But the reality is that if this problem had been solved, we'd be using these devices already. We're still using regular lithium-ion batteries with these liquid electrolytes. So what exactly is holding this problem up? And before I tell you that, I do need to explain very briefly what exactly the electrolyte is doing inside your battery. And a good place to start would be to tell you about the most basic of electrolytes, which is just salt in water. And what happens, table salt is composed of sodium and chlorine. I've got those two chemical elements here on the screen for you on the right. And what happens is that the water molecules here are represented by this little diagram I have of oxygen molecules with two hydrogens attached. What they do is that they drive the separation of the salt into their ionic components. So much like the lithium ions I was telling you about, table salt dissolved in water actually separates into these ions as well, where the oxygen atoms attack the positively charged sodium atoms and form this shell around them. And this is how salt dissolves in water. And moreover, you can actually, if you apply an electrical current to this or electrical potential like you would in a battery, you can actually get ionic current inside the electrolyte, much like you would in your lithium-ion battery, where you have an ionic current of lithium going across the battery from the anode to the cathode. Now, how exactly can this work in solid materials? Well, there's a solid material that's been studied very extensively since the 1970s for its ability to dissolve salts, much like water does. And it's known as polyethylene oxide, or PEO. And what it essentially is, just imagine this very long chain molecule, almost like a snake. And every so often on the backbone of this snake, you've got an oxygen atom attached or directly embedded into the spine of the snake. And if you mix this under the right conditions with the salt, it can actually pull the salt apart, much like water can. And I've got an example of that here on the screen, where instead of sodium chloride or table salt this time, I've got a lithium salt, where instead of sodium, we've got lithium. And this lithium chloride has been separated by this wriggling polyethylene oxide chain. The reason we use these in batteries, not only can they dissolve these salts, they actually, even though the material is solid, so if you're actually able to look at PEO, it actually looks like a powder. So it's macroscopically solid, but then on the microscopic scale, these chains, much like snakes, are sliding and slithering past each other all the time. And in the process of doing so, they can actually move lithium ions around within the chain. And the way they do this as they slide past each other is just passing lithium ions from one oxygen site to another in the polymer matrix, much like I have here on the screen for you. The only issue with PEO is that the conductivity, which is the measure of how quickly these ions move around inside the solid polymer, is actually very low. And the unit we use for that is known as a Siemen, and or Siemens per centimeter. And this right now is on the order of 0.00001 Siemens per centimeter, which is fairly low, and it's about 100 times lower than the conductivity we need for these polymers to actually work in real batteries. So the liquid electrolytes I was telling you about earlier actually have conductivities like the one in the red, where they're just 0.001 Siemens per centimeter, or a millisiemen per centimeter. So how exactly do you go about improving this kind of thing? And one way that's been posited is to try another atom on that backbone besides oxygen. And the system I'm studying actually uses boron instead of oxygen to do this. And the idea here would be that instead of wrapping around the lithium ion, it actually wraps around the negatively charged ion and leaves lithium ion relatively free to move about. So part of the problem, or part of the reason why polyethylene oxide doesn't have a high conductivity, is that even though it dissolves the salts very well, and that snake-like reptation actually promotes the movement of those lithium ions, the binding, or the how tightly those chains wrap around the lithium is very pronounced, and it's much tougher to undo than it would be in the case of water. And the idea here is that going to something like boron, which would attack that a negatively charged ion, would actually leave the lithium freer to move about inside the solid polymer. So just a quick primer on how I actually make this stuff for measurement. So I've actually got this kind of polymer electrolyte sitting in solution. And what I do is I cast it onto these stainless steel discs. And I leave it around to dry for a bit, so the solvent, or the stuff that's dissolving the polymers and the salts, evaporates off, just leaving the solid behind. And this is kind of what the films look like here on the left. And then I assemble them into this apparatus where I'm squeezing them all together and applying an electrical signal to measure the conductivity of the films. And what I can tell you is that the conductivity of the films I study, unfortunately, is not too great. So it's on the order of 0.000, that's 3, 000, that's 6, 0, 7, 7 zeros, and then a 1 Siemens per centimeter. So this is, compared to PEO, PEO is rather 1,000 times more conductive than the system I'm studying. That being said, though, doesn't mean that this isn't worth studying at all. And part of that has to do with the fact that as we change certain parameters, like the amount of salt that's in my polymer and the temperature as well, we can better understand how stuff is moving around in this system. And once we have a handle on that, that can actually tell us how to improve the system, and it might actually give us some insight into how to improve something that's already widely understood, like PEO. And you'll find that a lot of times in science, things don't work out as well as you hope, and that most of the stuff you'll end up working on probably won't find application in the way that you hope it does. But the idea is that there are many people working on these problems at the same time, and that by contributing your little piece, maybe that information will help somebody else, either now or down the road, to try and figure these problems out and push the field as a whole together. So we've come to the end of my talk, and before I leave you, I do want to give you a bit of a summary of why I do what I do. And the first thing, and I think this probably became apparent on the last slide, was that the system I'm studying probably isn't going to be the solution to the energy storage problem. And this is probably the case for a number of other people who are researching the same thing I do. The key thing, though, is that by understanding these novel systems, we can generate the kind of insight we need to make them better and actually improve already existing technologies so that we can actually enable this transition to renewable energy. Moreover, for me, it's very important that I work on something that I find socially relevant and valuable. And this energy storage problem is in the greater context of climate change. We want to move away from fossil fuels. And even though, again, my system probably or most likely will not be the solution to this issue, I am contributing my little piece to helping all of us solve these big problems. Moreover, I would like to add that my story or my ability to be here talking to you about this today, it's not just of my own accord. There are people behind me who helped me get to this point, and these struggles over the course of generations eventually culminated in me being able to talk to you here today. And I'd also like to tell you that it's never too late to start something new. That was definitely my case. I'd studied something completely different than what I'm doing now. But as long as you find what you want to do worthwhile, then by all means, go ahead and do that. This life is too short to waste that time regretting or thinking about what ifs. So if there's something you really want to do, just go ahead and do that. So that's my talk, and I really appreciate you listening to me today. Thank you.
Thank you for attending today's Science Journey presentation. Here at Caltech, we thank Mitch Aiken and Kitty Cahalan of the Center for Teaching, Learning, and Outreach, as well as Mary Herrera and Kara Steeman from the Office of Public Programming, and the teams from Academic Media Technologies and Event Productions. And special thanks to Robin Javier and Brian Brophy. Additionally, we thank the Caltech Employees Federal Credit Union, the Friends of Beckman Auditorium, and our many sponsors who make these programs possible. We look forward to you joining us again for future science lectures and performing arts events. Learn more by visiting events.caltech.edu.